Hello, this is Mike Hayslip, your host for this segment of Garland Perspectives, a series of visits with some special people who've contributed to Garland's growth and development. These visits are sponsored by the Garland Sesquicentennial Committee in celebration of our state's 150th birthday in 1986. Our guest here in the Storer Cable Studios is Haskell Lafayette Roach, born at 116 West Avenue D in Garland on December 17, 1897. His father, William Haskell Roach, came to the Garland area in 1890 from Rock Hill, South Carolina, and married a native girl named Rosabel Pace. Her grandfather, George Washington, or Wash Ruth as he was known, came to these parts from Tennessee about 1850 and bought a section of land that extended from Central Park down the south side of Avenue D to First Street and north to Castle Drive. Both parents were children of Confederate soldiers, his father serving under General Lee and hers under General Jackson, losing a leg in the process. Haskell Roach had a younger sister, Ruth, who taught in Garland schools for 35 years. The Ruth Roach Elementary School is named for her. In 1925, Haskell married Virginia Elizabeth Copeland from Lindale, Texas, after meeting her at Baylor University. They had one son, Richard, who lives and works in Garland. Virginia Roach left us in 1974. Hack Roach is a little bit younger than Garland is, but his life parallels that of the growth of the city. He graduated from Garland schools in 1915, from Baylor in 1920. He's always worked in Garland. He loaded skeet on Garland's fairgrounds in the early years. He worked at his father's cotton oil mill. He worked at the Roach Grocery Company from 1920 to 1928. He was a principal in the Jones Hardware Company from 1929 to 1933, and in 1933, he founded the Roach Feed and Seed Company. Aside from work, Mr. Roach has served as city councilman for two terms in the 1930s. He was an organizing director of the North Texas Municipal Water District. He served as chairman of the board of Garland Federal Savings, now First Garland Savings, and as chairman of the board of First National Bank in Garland, now Republic Bank Garland. His memberships include the Chamber of Commerce, where he is a past president, and in 1986 will be the recipient of the Tall Texan Award of the Chamber. He's a charter member of the Garland Rotary Club with a 58-year perfect attendance. He's a lifelong member of the First Baptist Church in Garland, a 32nd degree Mason, and a member of the Scottish Rite. Have we got the right guy? Does this sound like you?
I don't know what it sounds like, but that story's right.
Well, that's good. We're glad to have you here today. What are your earliest recollections of Garland? If you had to form a mental picture?
Oh, I don't know. I imagine my first recollection that I remember very distinctly was the second fire that destroyed Garland. I heard the alarm, you know, that we have. We don't have these sirens now like we do. You know how they used to do that?
No, I don't. What was it, a bell or what was it?
No, you'd go get your six shooter and your shotgun and go out and keep shooting those off until you got a lot of people to the fire.
I see. And that would have been in about 1898, I believe.
No, that 98 was the first one.
Okay.
I don't remember that one, but I remember the one in 4 and 5.
1904 and 5. Was it on the square or was it in a residential area?
On the square. Both of them on the square.
I see. So you remember the gunshots being fired into the air, and your first recollection of Garland is gunfire.
That's right.
Well, that's... Why was it that your family came to Garland initially?
Well, my father came here in 1890. He had been having some trouble with his health, having pneumonia every winter. And so the doctor told him that he was going to have to go west or he'd die with TB. So he knew some people that lived at Pleasant Valley, which is a little neighborhood just about 6 miles out of Garland at that time. They had a general merchandise business. Their people had come from Rock Hill before him. So he wrote Gus McCollum and asked him if he knew where he could get a job or some work to do out here, that he was going to have to go west. So Mr. McCollum wrote him back, told him to come ahead. He had a job, and he could live with he and his wife and family until he got located. So that's how come him to come to Garland.
And he met your mother after coming here, one of the local girls.
That's right.
And he found no reason to leave.
Found no reason to leave.
Now, you were born here, and you grew up here. You had a university degree in a time when that was not the usual thing to have, but you elected to stay here also.
That's right.
Why was that?
Well, being a native born, I thought that was the thing to do, and of course I was sitting there on some land too, so didn't want to go off and leave that. And no, I really wanted to make my life work in Garland.
Well, that's good. We're glad you've done that. One wonders what would have happened if some point down along the line we had lost you to somewhere else. Tell me a little bit, since your father came from Rock Hill, South Carolina, it's my understanding that there are a number of families in Garland who also trace their roots back to the area of Rock Hill, South Carolina. Now, you mentioned a family named McCollum. Of course, your Roach family traces its roots back there. There were some others, were there not?
Well, of course, my mother's people were from Tennessee. It seemed like after the Civil War, so many people moved from those southern states to Texas because Texas land was cheap out here, and they were wanting to make a new home for themselves. And some of the people would go from one different city, and then other people at the same time, same town, would follow them out later. And I guess there's 10 or 12 families that had come around Rock Hill to Garland.
Let's see if we can name a few of them, because we have another interview with another lady whose family came from there. So the ones that I would recollect would be the McCollum group, your
Agnew
group.
And, Agnew and Thompson.
And, do you remember any first names on the Agnews or Thompsons?
The old man was named Jeff Agnew, I believe. I'm not sure about that, but they had quite a family. One of the sons and I finished high school in the same class.
Okay, was there a Rab family that?
Rabs, I don't know where they came
from. Well, I find it very interesting that Garland seemed to be a relocation, resettlement outpost from that one little county with so many prominent families that have been here and stayed here all these years. You went to school on what was at that time the school site, which was
the only school in Garland.
Okay, the only school in Garland, and that would be between Avenue A and Avenue B, and bounded by 9th Street on the front and 10th on the back. What do you remember about your school days here? Are there any things that stand out about teachers or subjects that you took?
Well, my first teacher when I was in grade schools, superintendent of schools, was Thomas W. Platt. He was a big, very stern man, appearingly, and he stood for law and order. And the way when they'd dismiss us for recess or noon for lunch, and they'd call us back, he had a triangle that he used, you know.
Right, with a striker.
That's the way they'd get us back into school.
Where did you go for lunch?
Well, he just took your bucket, went out and opened it up and ate on the school ground.
I see.
They wouldn't let you leave the school ground unless you went home for lunch.
How did you get to school in those days?
Walked.
You walked. Now, you lived within a mile of school, so that wasn't a great inconvenience for you.
Yeah,
but what about those students that didn't live that close?
They either some rode horseback, some if they had more than one going to school there at the same time, they'd probably come in a buggy, horse and buggy.
Now, when they got there, what did they do with the horses and the buggies?
They had places where they unhitched their horse from the buggy and tied them up and left them around until school over in the afternoon.
I see. Now, we're fortunate in Garland to have a number of very large and well-appointed school buildings here. Can you tell us something more about that school building? I believe it was two or three stories, wasn't it?
It was three stories, brick building, big building, and the boys played on one side and the girls played on the other.
Now, was that all ages?
All ages, yeah.
Is this out in the yard for some kind of break or recess?
Yeah, break or recess.
So they kept the boys and the girls separated.
That's
back
right.
During recess. I see.
So on one of these particular days after recess, party would go in from the rear, party would go in from the front of the school, and I was about the third grade, something like that. I heard the bell and rang and ran back, and the big boys were coming from the other side, and I got run over and got knocked unconscious. They had to come get me and take me home.
You didn't have a school cafeteria then, back then?
No, didn't know what a cafeteria was.
Okay, so there was no such thing as a hot meal to complain about, or
no.
the cost of, or what they served you. So they did you have any sort of a central meeting room or an auditorium there?
No, not then. No.
What did you do in inclement weather when it was time to open the lunch bucket?
You stayed inside.
In the hallways or in the room?
Yeah, in your room. They'd let you eat in your room if it was bad weather.
And suppose there was no carpet on the floor, no air conditioning like we have today. What were the restroom facilities like in that school?
In that school?
Yes, sir.
Didn't have any.
Okay, so they didn't have any in the school. They were then behind the school, right?
Yeah, behind the school, and had a bucket out there, a cooler that you got your water out of. Practically everybody drank out of the same cups.
A dipper or a cup?
Yeah.
Did it have a well on site? Do you remember whether it...
I'm not sure about that.
Okay, so you had...
I'm sure they did, because they wouldn't have hall water up there. There's a well there, I'm sure.
Okay, so do you recall how many students there were in that building? You had every age group.
Oh, I'd say possibly 100 to 150.
So it wasn't hard to count.
No.
When the time came up. You went on to Baylor University after that. How did you select Baylor?
Well, wrote A&M first for catalog, and I didn't see the courses that I liked there, so mother said, why don't you write Baylor and get a catalog and see what they have to offer? And so I did, and it looked all right. And being of a Baptist family, well, I decided to go to Baylor.
Do you recall what it cost you to go to college for a year, about, in those days?
I think my first year, I only went two terms the first year. It cost me about $500, tuition, room and board, and everything.
Were you living high on the hog for $500, or were you just barely scraping?
Living about as good as I do now, as far as everything you needed.
Okay, $500 was a lot of money in those days. Do you recall anybody else from your graduating class that went away to a university for any period of time?
Oh, there's probably one or two would go from each senior class. The class wasn't too small.
Right. What sort of courses did you take at Baylor?
Oh, I just took straight literary courses like we had in high school, only they were a little more sophisticated.
What we would call liberal arts or general English history, arts, that sort of thing you took down there. Okay, we talked a little bit about what it was like to work and study. I know that you weren't always working and studying, so let's think a little bit about recreation and leisure activities in Garland back then. What was it like to be a teenager in the teens? Where did you go for dates, let's say?
Well, of course, usually if girls and boys didn't live around, they're fairly close. See, it was, town was pretty scattered in those days. You know, a lot of students came in from the country, and there's very small bunch of people lived in Garland when I was in grade school. And you'd usually pick you out a girl that you liked from within your class. And
what, you mean grade?
Yeah, grade.
Okay.
Yeah. And then about the only chance you had to see them was unless you went to their home, and you'd have to walk to and from.
Okay, so you were within Garland the whole time?
Oh,
it
yes.
Was not a question of going to Dallas for some kind of date. And you went on your dates on foot as
That's
a rule.
Right.
Okay, what sort of parties or activities went on in the early teens? I believe you told me once that you had dances or parties in homes.
Yeah, all the parties. Every weekend, probably, if weather was right, well, somebody'd have a few couples in, have a little party. They'd have games and play dominoes or cards like they used in those days.
So those were the games, the indoor games.
Indoor games, yeah.
Dominoes and cards.
And if you went anywhere, you and your date would have to walk.
Okay.
And a lot of the fathers and mothers didn't want their daughter walking out away from home very far at night.
Didn't want them walking with you, or didn't want them walking, period?
Period.
Okay. The other games, the outdoor sports, what were those like?
Baseball was about the only thing you played, and then football was the only two games. Didn't have basketball then. And that is about the only two games played.
I believe that Garland in those days had what was called a fairgrounds or a park.
That's right.
It would have been located west of First Street, would it not?
East of First. West of First Street, between First and Third.
Okay. And that happened to be about in front of your house, as I recall.
Yeah.
So you were on the scene for whatever went on at
the
fairground. What sort of thing did they do on the fairgrounds in those days?
Well, they had horse racing, like they do now, or what do they call these carts?
Oh yeah, with a cart or a buggy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they had races over there. Did they ever bet on them?
I imagine it is. Yeah.
You wouldn't know, but human nature being what it is. Okay, what about any team sports other than baseball or any other sorts of exercise? Do you recall any of those?
That's the only two that I played in.
Okay. Well, what happened when you got sick in those days? What were the medical facilities like in town?
Well, of course, they had a doctor that would you'd call in.
One?
No, there was two or three.
Okay.
Here at that time, so I remember. And they'd come to your home. They usually they'd come by horse and buggy then, until later on, sometime up in the early 1900s, you began to get cars.
Well, the doctors were some of the first people with cars?
Yes, they're the ones that had the money.
So they had the cars, and they would come to the home. Do you remember any sort of medicines that were given in those days, or what were the treatments?
Well, they'd score what was the matter with you. They'd call you in, look at your tongue, take your temperature, and ask you to give them a history of the case. And then if you were bilious, so they'd give you Calomel. Mm-hmm. If you had fever, they'd give you quinine.
Okay, what do you mean bilious? That's a word that a lot of folks may not know.
Needing a purgative.
Okay. Swelled and as a part. Okay. Or quinine or what else?
Oh, quinine mostly. Okay. For fevers and things like that.
So,
they had a good deal of typhoid fever every summer and so forth.
So a drugstore didn't have to be very large back in those days to have all the medicines that were
That's
used.
Right.
How many drugstores did we
Most
have?
Most of the doctors had a case that they carried these medicines with them. They'd mix it up and put it in capsules right there while you were there. They'd prescribe it and dose it out to you.
Dispensed it as well.
Yeah.
I believe you told me once that at one point in your life it was decided that you needed a tonsillectomy.
That's right.
How was that all carried out?
Well, I had to go into Dallas to have that done, so I had to go by train. So we went down to see the doctor and decided to have it. So I go into Dallas in the morning, about the train left about 9 o'clock, get in there about 9:45 or 10, go up to the doctor's office, and he'd sit down in a chair, and only gave you local anesthesia.
Mm-hmm.
Strap your arms down, and they cut them out. You, after you got through, they'd let you lie down in the office there at the back of the spare room or something. And then when the train left that afternoon to go home about 3:15 or 4 o'clock, I caught the train home.
You don't remember what a doctor's visit cost or that tonsillectomy cost, do you?
No.
You wouldn't have been paying for it in those days,
no.
So you wouldn't recall what it was. When you got back from Baylor University, you got immediately into business and civic affairs in Garland, is that right?
That's right.
You were involved, as we said earlier, in the Chamber of Commerce activity of that day, which was probably called the Garland Commercial Club at that time.
Yeah, I think that's right. Look, the time I got out of school, I think they changed it to Chamber of Commerce that time, yeah.
Okay. You've told me in years past about the founding of the Rotary Club. Maybe you could share that with us, since you've been a charter member and had a perfect attendance for 58 years. What do you remember about that?
Well, I'd say the middle of the 20s, why we had people that would come out from Dallas, try to organize a Rotary Club or a Lions Club. They were about the only first two that dinner clubs that I know of. And our people that weren't in business there thought that would be kind of a opposition to the Chamber of Commerce, and we didn't want to interfere with anything. It would hurt the Chamber of Commerce, so we turned them down.
You didn't want to found the clubs in Garland or a chapter in Garland?
Didn't want it at that time, so finally they kept insisting because they wanted to have a club close to Dallas where they could make up their attendance. And they came out and they talked to about 8 or 10 of us people in the business then, and we decided to organize a club.
A Rotary Club.
Rotary Club. And we did, and started off with 1927 with 16 charter members. And
where did you meet?
We met at Moore's Inn, which is down on Duck Creek at that time. She ran a boarding house and served dinners and things like that on the weekends, and she agreed to served the Rotary luncheons. She was very good with homemade cooking, hometown cooking, we call it, and fried chicken and so forth.
I believe you told me the whole Rotary Club out here was built on fried chicken and pie at one time.
Well, the problem was we only had 16 members, and these people come out from Dallas and they found this good food out here. We'd have usually from 40 to 50 members from downtown Dallas, so she rarely ever knew what to fix for them because
they'd just drop in. Well, that must have made it fun to try to figure out how much to prepare.
Well, it was hard on us trying to have a program with that many people when we didn't know what was going to do, see.
What can you tell us, that's the service aspect of it, what can you tell us about businesses that you've been involved in? I believe you and your father got involved in the Roach Grocery Company about 1920.
Right.
How did that come about? You'd just gotten out of Baylor, you were back home.
Well, my dad asked me in my senior year in college what I was planning to do when I got out of school, and I told him, well, I'd been interviewed by several different business concerns that came there and took a few out of the graduating class each year.
Could I interrupt you and ask you if you remember who any of those were?
Southwest Bell and that's a telephone company.
Yeah, utilities.
Yeah, utilities and things like that.
So you had considered going to work for one of those.
Yeah.
And could have done so. But your father called and said...
He said, well, said, what do you think about coming back into Garland and going into business? He said, Garland's your hometown, your roots are here, and I think you can do better if you've got it in you. You can do better if you're in your own business and you can't work with the other fella.
Okay.
So that's what we decided to do.
So you became a second generation merchant. Then.
That's right.
Now, how did you go about establishing this grocery company?
We bought out Mr. Williams.
That would be Mr. M.D. Williams.
M.D. Williams, who ran, had dry goods, general merchandise, implements, and undertaking. So at this time, he had just four... We came home, he had sold his dry good business to Mr. L.A. Powell.
Okay.
And he had taken that over, and then he wanted to get rid of his grocery business. So we bought the grocery end of it from him.
What was the difference in the operation of a grocery store back then and what we know as the modern day supermarket?
Well, it was, if you could give them credit, and would extend them credit, why, you could get all the business you needed.
Okay.
Because then it was, you sold a farmer in the beginning of the year and carried him until September, October when he harvested his crops.
Okay, so a grocery business was also a bank of sorts.
That's
in
right.
Those days.
You took their note, agreed to furnish them so much groceries for the year, and if they had a good crop, they paid you, and if they didn't, they'd carry it over to the next year.
So you and your father were able to capitalize that financing operation, and therefore that was much of the reason that you could sell groceries in those days.
Yeah.
Because you could carry those notes. Tell me a little bit, if you could, what it was like in your recollection from, let's say, 1920 on, what we would call the economy in Garland. Knowing that we had an agricultural town in the early days and most of the business here was farming or merchants or banks serving those farmers. What were the ups and downs and the swings and the panics like?
Okay, you remember we had the First World War.
No, I don't remember.
1718. Well, land prices went up. Land went up from $50, $75 an acre to $400 an acre.
Now, was this farmland?
Farmland.
Okay. How far out?
Oh, any good farm would bring in 18, 19, and 20, got to where it'd bring as much as $400 an acre for farming. And they said land would never sell for less than that again. But 19, 20, they had a slump in business, and cotton dropped from 40 cents a pound down to 10 cents. And of course, the farmers, that was their money crop, and they always figured that the price was going to be better. And instead of selling it when they first got it out, at what it was bringing around 35 cents, why, they said they had to have 40 cents, and it just kept going down.
So they
down.
Held. They held the cotton.
Cotton went down to 10 cents, and then, of course, they never could pay their bills.
This was in 1920.
That was 1920.
All right, so we hear a lot about the Depression or the market crash nationally, but you're telling us we had our own crash here in 1920.
1920, because main people that bothered is the ones that had farms. See, they would sell their farm and buy a larger farm, pay more money, and give a note for the balance that they had to pay after they had traded the other farm in that on the larger one.
What was the means by which they sold these farms? Did we have active real estate promoters and agents? And
yes, they had a few real estate agents. Mostly, they worked up the deal themselves.
With a neighboring farmer or
yeah.
somebody else in town? How were those farms paid for back then? What was the financing like on them? Were they cash sales or were they
no,
notes?
No, they were bought on credit and so much a year. And anyway, they could make a trade.
I see. During this period of time, you were not only working in your own business, but you became later on affiliated with both a bank and a savings and loan association. When you joined the board of First National Bank, now Republic Bank Garland, look back to those days and what are the differences in the operations you see now other than the name, obviously, and the size of the bank. What do you remember as a board member of that bank in terms of financing or loan requests or the way people handle their business as opposed to today when you look at it?
Well, of course, being in a rural community and the way they had business here, you had to use different collateral and things like that, and you had to know the people you were dealing with, background and so forth. You didn't go in and make an application. You just go in and tell the man that you wanted to borrow so much money. And you didn't have to give a long list of what you got.
He already knew.
That's right. And doing business in was more on what you knew about your people and trust and faith in their ability to pay.
So could you say that your image or your reputation in town might have been even more important then than it is now in terms of borrowing money?
That's right.
Okay. Do you remember anything about the bank closing?
Yeah, sure do, yeah.
What do you recall about that?
Well, we were, that was 1933. We were building the building that I'm in now.
Down by the Santa Fe tracks.
Down on the Santa Fe Railroad.
Garland.
And I remember my father was on the board at the bank at that time. And Mr. E. R. Davis, who was president of the bank at that time, called my father over the phone and said he wanted him to come to the bank. I want to talk with him. So he went up there and he came back. He said, "Well," said, "we got some bad news." Said Mr. Davis said,